Welcome in. Welcome, New York. This is take two for us, episode 124. The club's finally got its own home. I think we just need the mayor to sign the papers. We've got our second win of the season and our first clean sheet of the season, surprisingly, coming in week 7. So that kind of sets the bar for where things have been so far. But a lot of things to talk about in this one, and I think just toss it off to you in between those topics. Where do you think we should go first?
I think definitely us having a new home, without a doubt. Like, that's the best news, the biggest news. It's really the only thing keeping us going at this point, because, you know, obviously we get the win last night, but it just seems like we were the better of two horrible teams. The game seemed very much like a MLS 1.0 type game. I don't even know where to go with it, but yeah, the new home, that's huge, you know, huge steps for that.
Yeah, I think when they voted on it, it was like 47-1 or something, and they're like, that's the biggest win that we'll ever have in club history. And it's just funny how it comes out to sounding like a scoreline like that. And obviously everybody kind of congregates together. I'm not sure if it was City Hall or whatever it was when they had Burke there and Maxi. I believe Freese was there too, and other players and kind of fans gathering to celebrate the moment. And then I guess rumors are that this upcoming weekend at City Field, Mayor Eric Adams is going to sign it officially at the stadium for everybody. So I don't know if that's going to happen. That would obviously be a monumental moment. It feels like it's pretty much guaranteed at this point. He kind of just has to put pen to paper. But I know, at least for us, being based in Connecticut, I think we've probably had a different relationship than a lot of the New Yorkers have had with the new stadium. But for us, it's always been the goal to make it as close as we can,
right,
to whatever the proposed site is. And obviously now we know it's Queens. So just to, I think, hopefully be a part of that community in the future, and then for Queens and kind of the other New Yorkers to get that as a part of their community along with everything they're bringing, is, you can't overstate what it means probably to that borough and to the community as well. They've been fighting for this for a while, so it's crazy. I'm really excited for it to exist. I hope we're not, you know, punting seasons until we get there, so that we can have a blast of a first season in it, because that's what a lot of people feel like at the moment. But it'll be interesting. It's going to be an amazing thing when it's finally open.
Yeah, I mean, not only for New York. I know it's huge for New York, but it's also big for America and soccer in America. You know, to be able to bring games from around the world to the actual city of New York. You know, it's not something that's really, I think, ever happened, or it's been a very, very long time since it has. So it's massive for all around. And yeah, if we're punting for them, they're going to have to drag me there, dude.
Well, it was funny too to hear, I think they were interviewing Maximo outside City Hall too about it. And like, he's obviously a super young kid, but his contract length is going to run him through that. And I don't know if it would be if all things go well with him, because I think if all things go well, maybe he won't be with us in 2027, right, at the trajectory that, you know, a lot of us believe he's at. But he would be the kind of player, if he ends up being long-term club player, that would be a staple of a team around that time.
You would hope so.
You would, yeah. If he is to be what he's supposed to, you would hope so. So yeah, it'll be interesting for the city. And I think also for New England, that we can definitely speak to, being from Connecticut. Like, the premier national soccer venue for New England is Rentschler Field.
Right.
Which, for those outside of Connecticut, you may not understand, like, that's just UConn's football stadium.
Yeah.
It's not soccer specific.
It is really nice, though.
It is nice, but there isn't anything truly special about it. And I think that it not being soccer specific part is a major thing. I know, at least when I was growing up, like, going to Gold Cup games, we have to drive out to the Meadowlands, and then now that I'm older, we understand that the players are going there, like, please don't let my ACL go on this turf, or, you know, whatever NFL stadium they're getting plugged into, whether that's Gillette or whatever it is. So this instantly, I think, becomes the staple soccer-specific thing for New England. And we'll have a national team game, hopefully more than once every 5 to 10 years.
Right.
Because that one, I think, over this last summer, right, you went and saw Germany and U.S. at Rentschler, and I don't remember the last time there was a national team game within a 2-hour driving distance of us, not to mention all of New England.
Right. Yeah, no, definitely. You know, not having to go to the Dead Bulls arena as well.
Yeah.
Is massive. So yeah, all around it's great. I feel like we need to build something starting now, as opposed to punting and hoping that we can build the team later
with our roster.
Yeah. Cause look, when nobody wants to come to a team that's getting results like this, it's not attractive. You know, we do get our second win, which felt good on the night. But just the more you think about it, it's like, it seems like this win was just because the other team was so much worse.
Right.
And could have, should have, whatever you want to say, been a man down as well early on. So, plus I think their left back got injured pretty quickly as well.
Yeah.
It was just all around a bad night for them, and it could have been a bad night for us as well.
And it kind of started off weird because the lineup wasn't exactly what we were expecting. I'm not sure if anybody ended up, I don't remember anybody asking about it in the post-match press conference, but Tavon got dropped from the lineup for Lenich, which is kind of out of the blue, especially after the performance we saw from Tavon last week, which felt like his best performance moving forward, right. In the attack, we mean. And then what ends up being a genius decision, I guess, is to get Ojeda in the starting lineup for the first time.
Right, which he ended up taking his chance.
Yeah, I mean, it was, if we talk about his goal, not to jump too far ahead, but that was amazing from him. The pace that he hit that ball with, and he kind of created it almost from nothing. He just decided to pull up from midfield. These are like the type of goals when we're watching other MLS games that we right. see someone score and we go, we don't have a guy in our team that can yeah. do that, and right. that's why we suck.
Yep.
But we do have these guys now.
Yeah, well, we do, but they need to show...
In theory.
Yeah, in theory. You know, they need to show it on a week-in, week-out basis. But it was just... It seemed like all of the frustration of the entire team went into his right foot for that goal. Like, he booted that thing. And it really came out of nowhere. Not necessarily against the run of play, but just like, you know, we were driving to Moe's and looking to get dinner. And like, it just didn't feel like... Like the moment building up to a goal, it just kind of it was like a flash out of nowhere.
Yeah.
But it's capitalizing on those type of things that makes teams good and gets results.
That's kind of what it's like in the MLS. Yeah, to be good, you kind of just have to capitalize on these small chances that may come from nothing or may come from mistakes of the other team. And yeah, New England was making a ton of mistakes. I think early on, it was a sloppy game. I think from both sides.
So ugly.
And that ref, to me, he wanted to make the game about himself. And I think in the second half, he ended up letting people play more. But I don't think through the first 20 minutes, there was probably a consecutive run of play that was longer than like a minute.
Yeah.
Which was obviously very frustrating. I think early on too, I was concerned. I was surprised that the Revs ended up getting a red card. I was concerned that we weren't going to have Jimmy this whole game.
Yeah. I mean, he was, you know, to the ref's credit, he was playing very sloppy. And very poor. It was uncharacteristic
Reckless.
Of what he's been. But just like sticking his foot where it shouldn't be, you know, making too many tactical fouls, like, and also in positions where it wasn't really necessary. Like, I think specifically of the one where the Revs player was going back towards his defenders, like literally running with the ball towards his defenders, and Sands fouls him. Mm-hmm. It's like, this guy's not a threat to anything right now. Like, just let him do it.
Yep.
Somebody else will pick it up. But I think that's all, I don't know how to say this, it's like all stemming from the fact that Sands feels like he has to do everything because everything around him has been so poor. And so I think all of that is leading to these little silly fouls.
Yeah, no, it makes sense. And I think he's kind of right in doing that too. You know, he may not want to put the team in a position where if he feels like he can stop an attack from even developing at the beginning of it, then we don't have to worry about somebody screwing it up later down the line. So, you know, I feel like you can't knock him for it too much. I definitely didn't think he was going to make it. I don't know
I didn't think so.
I don't know how he escaped with a yellow card because I think in the first 15, like three of those were all like in quick
in
succession.
Row.
Yeah, like he makes that first tackle where he tackles and then he goes through the guy. He carries on through it. And then I think on the one you were mentioning, he ends up elbowing the guy in the head. And it was just,
yep.
I thought we were going for Sands two red cards in a season for the first time.
And I mean, like, had they given Sands a red card after the elbow, just straight red, I wouldn't have even been mad at it. Like, the dude had a fat egg on his forehead.
Yeah.
Nose bleeding. Like, he obviously got roughed up in it, whether it was an intentional or not. But
looked like he was in the ring with Max Holloway.
Genuinely. Like, he looked like he got messed up. So, you know, I wouldn't have hated it. I think our defense in the beginning looked like crap on it, like terrible. And then they found a way to kind of like get it together. Like Thiago kind of brought it together. Risa was bringing it together a little bit. But in the beginning, I was ready to say like, dude, get rid of them both. Like, I don't want to see him ever play again.
Yeah.
It was so frustrating.
Yeah, well, I think we all went into this game thinking it should be a must-win, and
Right.
honestly, not expecting that it could be anything else but that. Like,
Right.
as bad as we've been, just knowing, I think, how much worse it feels like New England has been, we kind of assumed that this would be a win. It felt to me like going back to the Bronx, we've been building momentum more so the last few weeks than we really did the start of the season. It felt like we had to get one, and we were going to. And then to have it not come to fruition until so late in the game, there was early moments, I think, where it got pretty tense. And it must have been like that at the stadium too. I'm sure the chants were flying, have to be. But we eventually break through with Ojeda. But when we're talking about the attack, I kind of wanted to focus a bit more on Baki, who,
Munza.
Moussef. We've revoked the naming or the nicknames. I liked seeing him pull up from midfield, not midfield, that's crazy, but from outside of the box and take that shot. And I think that's super characteristic of him, obviously still being a pretty confident player despite being on one of the worst droughts that he's probably been in his career. And he hasn't really had the backing of fans or media. I don't know whether or not he really sees it, but that is a good thing to see from a striker. And I think that's a point worth driving home.
Yeah, 100%. Whether you have 0 goals like he does or 20 goals, it's good to see your striker get into a position where he feels comfortable enough to shoot and taking it. Like, there's nothing negative about that. Now, if you look and he had like 7 options that were better and he did that, yeah, that's something to complain about. But if you're complaining that he took that shot,
There really were no other options.
like there he one he created it for himself. Saw an opportunity to shoot and he took it. Like, if you're angry at that, you're just a sour person. Like, there's just not, there's no way there's no other way to say it.
And we're at a point too where there are no other options currently. There could be an argument that I don't know if people would prefer that we do something like stick Santi up top, which we have seen hasn't worked when we tried it this season, and then you lose our most productive player in the attack from his midfield position that he's best at. That obviously doesn't work. Jovan is stuck in Serbia, and JJ, for whatever reason, is sentenced to NYCFC too.
Right.
So it's we have to roll with him, and I think we as fans, especially if we have the wherewithal to know that he is the only option at the moment, like, we basically have to run him until he can't run anymore, because that's what our roster construction is at the moment. Then we have to support him. I think, we've tried to get behind Baki and support him through this tough drought, but we've also been on record, if we did have those other guys, we're with it.
Yeah,
Jovan,
we're down for them to play too.
we've been saying Jovan at this point, like, it's Baki sat if Jovan is present. If we had the, I don't know what to call it, the balls to bring JJ up from NYCFC to do something we've never done just to see what happens,
Yeah,
we're for it.
definitely.
And maybe that'll be a call that we'll be able to make ourselves, at NYCFC to get a better eye on JJ in person and see if it is something where you feel like it can translate to the big leagues.
Right. I mean, you see guys that have been featured in NYCFC 2 in our lineup, like Malachi, like Ojeda. Ojeda obviously gets a goal. Malachi should have had a goal. That's something maybe we should talk about, because that was wild that he didn't score. Those are the type of goals that, if Mounsef was on the end of that, I am confident, even in his current form, that he would finish that. Like,
Going out on a limb
that is
there.
like an ideal, the ideal position for a striker to be in. Obviously, Malachi doesn't take it, but it does not. I don't see how it can hurt to give JJ one game. Like, we've only won 2 and 7.
2-7. 2 draws, 3 or 4 losses, whatever the math is.
4 losses. Yeah. Yeah.
So no, I think you give
Like,
JJ the go.
literally, it can't get worse than that.
And we've proven that, like you said, we've proven that there's kids that have gotten a fair share of minutes with NYCFC that have come now
Right.
and delivered.
Think of Jason.
Think of Jason, and even more recent with Ojeda. Ojeda
Right.
scoring, Malachi, like you said, he should have finished that, and it's unfortunate he didn't. But when we're looking at that winger conversation, we obviously have Julian coming late and just the finesse from the gods from outside the
That's
box.
exactly what you want him to do.
With the left foot, like, it was textbook Julian. So moving forward, what do we do?
Oh, you know what we do.
I mean, we wrote the book last episode with what you do.
Yeah. Well, you take Hannes out.
Yeah, he has to be.
He has 0 goals, 0 assists this season. Out of 7 games, you plug other people in. You know, Cushing has shown with other positions that he's going to ride the hot hand. You know, with starting Alonso 2 games in a row, dropping him once he didn't score. Ojeda scores this game. Something tells me he's going to start the next game. Mm-hmm. And Julian scores, right? So, like, there isn't a world where those two guys don't start next game. There shouldn't be.
Yeah, Ojeda should be on the left, Julian on the right. And then you see how it goes. If we're going to be in that hot hand system, and I think we've supported riding the hot hand, but I think you want to push it a bit farther than Nick does. You know, even though it's hard to say with 2020 vision now because we know dropping Alonso ended up being the right decision. Right. But I do feel like, how do you exist in the world where you can keep running Baki for 7 games straight, no production in terms of stats? And it's like, well, he's got to be the guy again. And part of that is roster and everything like that. But Jovan was here for 5 of those games.
Right.
JJ has always been an option. And we've messed around with other systems, you know, whether it's getting Santi up top, or you can't tell me that you can't have one of these young wingers run around at the 9 and it would look too much worse than what we're seeing.
Yeah.
So how is it that Alonso scores the goal as a sub, gets 1 start, doesn't produce a meaningful stat, and is dropped from the lineup? I think you have to ride it a bit longer, especially with how early it is in the season. It's maybe a bit risky to say there's a lot of soccer left, because it catches up to you quickly.
Right.
When it's week 30.
Right. And you're like, we got 4 more games.
Yeah, you're in 13th place.
Right.
And it's like coming down to decision day. But I think healthily you can take that into consideration. You know, if there's any summer plans related to transfers that they would be privy to, the Cushing and the staff, then you might know, okay, we can take a little time here to look at players that we have with a closer look if we know we're going to get reinforcements that could help save us later. But I'd like to see, regardless of it ending up being the wrong decision, like giving these guys more opportunity to build chemistry, to build confidence. Because I can't imagine now Alonso might feel the next time he gets in, like, if I don't score a goal, I might not get a game. I might not get a minute
but also
for another
good.
Month or two.
But, like, good.
There's an argument
like
there,
there
too.
There should be some pressure. There should be some exterior motivators to push these guys. Mm-hmm. Because it's just not good enough. And Ojeda, I think, can do a job if he's stuck in that position. It's what he was brought here to do. If you're looking at summer transfers, in my opinion, you have to bring in a striker. I know Jovan has not had any chance, but you also need you need somebody else, in my opinion, because these guys have both shown that they're going to go play for their national team. That's why we don't have Jovan currently.
Yeah.
Right. So we need another striker if you're not going to pull JJ up in those situations, which we've shown we are not. We need another center back, because the one we got is trash. Just point blank period. We don't have good center backs.
It's a bit harsh.
But it just is what it is.
Yeah.
It is what it is.
Yeah. And you need a left back. And that might be top of the list.
Yeah. Like somebody, just start using the guys that you have, which would be, I mean, it's wild to say. Yeah. I know it's wild to say, but like if you have McFarlane, why are you not using him?
If you have a Tavon that can put a shift in and you don't love what you're seeing from Kevin.
Correct.
There's an opportunity there.
So, you know, but there are some targets in the summer, but obviously way too early to be talking about that, I think.
And then I think kind of tying it up in a bow, this might just become a regular segment on the show, is finding a way. We don't even have to find a way to fit Freese into a conversation. He is
the conversation.
He is the conversation.
He is the conversation.
So does he, there were a few saves in this that were obviously insane. You have the one-on-one early. I can't remember who it was that broke free, and he kind of has to jump to his right and make that one-handed save. And then you have the one where he committed to the left pretty much fully, like, you know, fully lays out to the left and then has to recover himself at the end of the game. It might have been the 86th minute to jump back to his right and save that shot. Is it enough?
The open header.
Right.
That he saved.
Yeah. Did he do enough that he gets a man of the match now for a 4th week in a row over, I guess it would have to be Ojeda if you had to give it to one 100%. Of the 2 goal scorers.
Yeah, 100% the man of the match. I think any time that the keeper has a bunch of saves like that, keeps a clean sheet. On our team, he has to be the man of the match. Has to be. When our defenders sell like they do constantly, have to. You have to give him the nod. I just think that the only other guy that you can think of really is like Santi.
Yeah.
Santi, even though he goes without a goal, still a great shift, in my opinion. I think he was really pissed off to come off.
Yep.
Like, I don't think he wanted to at all. But, yeah, I think it's got to be either Freese or Santi.
Yeah. No, I would go Freese again. And I think four goalkeeper man of the matches in a row really tells a story of where the attack is at, where a club is at. Yeah. But it does feel a bit like we're on an upswing, right? And
definitely.
It's not to put too much stock into beating a wounded New England. A New England without three or four starters.
Right.
So next, I believe we've got DC United at Citi Field. Yeah, we do. The rumored Eric Adams contract signing game. And they have the red hot Benteke, who I want, if not the golden boot leader, definitely
up there.
Definitely up there. Is the magic? Do you think the magic of the night saves us? The magic of the final proper approval saves us? Or I don't know if a Thiago Martins is gonna have the gall to stop a Benteke, and that's what concerns me. City.
I think Thiago can do it. I think he can do it. Stopping him is like a loose term, right? Like slowing him down would probably be the better term.
Slowing down.
But look, like Benteke is not Suarez, and Suarez was handled outside of fouling Sands. Outside of fouling Sands and missing a lot of shots, like what did Suarez do?
Mm-hmm.
And that's beside my hate for Suarez. That's like right. Separate of it.
There's definitely no personal opinion leaking into the.
Not at all. But Benteke, he is a dog. Like he's literally, he's a dog. So it's a tough assignment, but I don't know that DC as a whole can overcome all of the things that we have going for us on the night with, you know, coming off of a win, being at Citi Field, which is like, in my opinion, that's our real home right now.
Yeah.
Like that's where they feel the most love. I think the players might even say that Citi Field's their favorite. And then obviously all the things surrounding the stadium. Like, all of those things, in my opinion, it's a win. And I think even if those things weren't happening, I'd probably say that.
Yeah,
yeah, no. We're leaving with a dub.
Leaving with a dub. It'll be a great post-game podcast, if that's the case. 100%. And it'll be the highest that we've been on the season.
I'm not above asking Benteke for a signature.
Okay.
I'm not above that.
You're not above that? Tuck in the credentials.
He might even have to sign my credentials.
Sign the credentials. No, that, I mean, that would make sense. That's like if, you know, if you walk past Messi in the hallway, there's no way you don't try to give him knuckles or
something. But take your glasses off, probably.
Yeah. But then you might get caught by a bodyguard.
No, that bodyguard is insane.
He has... If
he decides if you dap up.
Yeah.
Like, you don't decide that. Messi doesn't even decide that.
Yeah. Did you see him, the kid ran on the field at the end of the game? Bro, we might have to give him a contract, a striker. Like, that guy, if we could just be long ball FC and play crosses up to him, the pace on the guy is crazy.
For probably his age.
Yeah.
Like, I was running the other day. It was hard. It's my age. Like, just.
And he's probably got 20 years.
Dude, he's at least 25 years, easily.
I mean, that is probably it, though. I know we have the Open Cup game upcoming a few days from now.
Yep.
So probably some big talking points coming out of that on our following episode. I guess our next one would be a wrap-up of the DC game, wrap-up of NYCFC2 and Hartford Athletic Open Cup game. Hopefully the boys can get a dub in that one. That'll be pretty exciting. And I think maybe we'll get an opportunity to interview some of the young players if we get to. I know after the game at Belsen against the Red Bulls, they did some media availability. So we'll see who's available, if any. I know it's at an opposing... an opposing stadium. So
ask JJ what he thinks about not getting called up.
I think we might just get asked to leave.
Yeah, Swan's gonna be like, he's not answering my question.
Yeah, any other questions? But yeah, so that's 124. Some things to look forward to. I think we'll also be pitching some ideas to the powers that be at NYCFC at the Open Cup game, knowing I think it'll be a bit more personal than it is at the press box at Yankee Stadium, because we've got about a 2,500 seat venue, and I think press wise we might be sitting at picnic tables with the powers that be in Cushing.
Yeah,
if in a perfect world.
Yeah, if Cushing goes, which I think
he was at the Red Bulls game, but
I'd assume he'd go.
It was in New York. I would hope he would
go. It's not that far for him.
As a fan, I think I'm hoping the first team manager is making the hour 45-minute drive to watch the second team in a win or go home game.
Right. And Hartford's kind of gassing it, bro. Hartford's gassing a little bit with this like golden ticket. Like if you win and you go to this game, you get free tickets to the next one.
And I think it's $2 beer, $5 hot dog, or is it $2 hot dog, $5 beer? Can Cushing
drink on the job?
Something like that. That's a good question.
Because we are not allowed to.
Yeah. Like,
that's specifically stated. We cannot drink
on the job. Is it technically his job if he's going to watch the game? I guess it is in a way.
If it's just his own free will, or if they're paying for his travel, he can't drink.
Are we allowed to get him one and see what secrets can be divulged under?
Or just ask him, like, what are you doing after the game?
Yeah.
Take him to the Ukrainian lady.
I don't know. We might get hit with an NDA or something crazy, which I'm open to.
I am open to that.
Yeah.
I'd sign anything.
I'm fully open to keeping the secrets from the listeners just for myself.
Yeah. I'm going to, like, if he is there, I'm going to be the asshole that's like, have you considered this formation? What if you had Keaton Parks in the hole?
I can just imagine if we're sitting somewhat close to him, like, I think JJ would look pretty good on the first tier.
just talk really loud.
Try to do this psychology thing where we're putting ideas in his brain, and then maybe at the training pitch, he's like, I don't know why, but I feel like maybe this is his week. This is his week.
What if we had two strikers up top?
If we just say it enough times, it might plant itself in there. So we'll do our best. We'll be on the front lines.
What if we sign Aguero? Hardy's available.
We'll do our best. We're gonna plant the psychological seeds. Hopefully, you could trust in that. We'll be on the front lines. If we can get any information out of anybody, it'll be presented here.
Yep.
And overall, just hoping for a win. I think in that game, win against DC, and then we keep building yep. on results. Hopefully, the players can keep building on confident results amongst themselves too. I'm excited to see what Ojeda can really be, because he came in as, you know, a player with a lot of prospect, but largely unproven.
Definitely.
So I guess that's 124. Subscribe, like,
comment. Say that we're horrible and our takes are bad.
Comment NDA if you heard this. Comment
NDA Cushing.
NDA. Otherwise, we'll catch you guys after the next game.
See you guys.
Peace.